So this is the third video in a series of videos where we're solving systems of linear equations. In the first video, we solved a system of linear equations that had a single, unique solution. In the second video, we solved a system of equations that we found had no solution. In this video, here is our new system of equations that we'll be working with. And in this particular example, we'll find that this system of equations has an infinite number of solutions to the equations. So here's our system of equations. Again, the system of equations looks very similar to those we saw in parts A and B. There's just been some minor changes, but that has a big impact on the solution of this system. We're going to start off the problem like we've started off the last two videos. We're going to form the augmented matrix. So all of the x1, x2, and x3 coefficients go here. And the right side of the equation, 2, 3, and 5, go right here. So this is what we call the augmented matrix. And then we're going to use the same strategy to solve this system of equations again. We're going to perform row operations and manipulate this matrix into a form that we can pick off the solution. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to swap equations 1 and 2. That's the same strategy we've done the last couple videos because we want a 1 up here. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get a 0 right here, and I'm going to get a 0 right here. So I can get a 0 in the second row by letting equation 2 equal 4 times equation 1 plus equation 2. And I can get the other 0 I need by letting the third equation equal 3 times the first equation plus the third equation. So if I do that, the first equation is unchanged. Equation 2 turns into 0, negative 1, 2, and 14. And the third equation turns into 0, negative 1, 2, and 14. So this is interesting. Right away we notice these last two equations now are identical to each other. So that's very interesting. So let's go ahead and do this. Let's let the third equation equal the third equation minus the second equation. So I'm going to have 0 minus 0, and I'm going to have a negative 1 minus a negative 1, and 2 minus 2, and 14 minus 14. That's going to turn this bottom equation into zeros. And that's very important. Anytime I encounter a full row of zeros in an augmented matrix like this, that means something very special. What that means is that the variable x3 is what we call a free variable, which means that in the solution of this system of equations, x3 is allowed to be any value we choose, and then x1 and x2 are going to have values based on the value we choose for x3. But in general, x3 is what we call a free variable. You might wonder, why is x3 the free variable? I'm allowed to interchange rows, right? So I could make the row of zeros be the top row, and then x1 would be the free variable. So that is totally fine to do. It's more conventional to put the free variables here towards the bottom, but if you want to make x1 the free variable and interchange rows 1 and 3, that's totally fine to do. Then x1 would be your free variable. The way the solution would end up being parameterized would look a little different, but the set of solutions would still be identically the same. So you're not going to get a different answer. You're just going to get an answer that looks a little different, but in the whole will be the exact same answer. So don't worry about that. All right, let's go ahead and continue. Let's go ahead and negate equation 2 and turn that negative 1 into a 1. Just a little bit easier to read. And then finally, let's let E1 equal E1 plus 2E2. We can get some zero right here. Simplify that equation a little bit. So equation 2 and 3 are unchanged, and equation 1 is the only thing that changed. And now this is pretty easy to pick off what these equations right here mean. So what does that first equation mean? That first equation says that x1 is equal to 3x3 minus 25. Really what this says is x1 minus 3x3 is equal to a negative 25, but I've gone ahead and moved the negative 3x3 to the other side by adding 3x3 to both sides. Similarly, that second equation says that x2 is equal to 2x3 minus 14, and then the bottom full row of zeros means that x3 is a free variable. So this is actually the solution to this system of equations. x3 can be any number, and then once I've chosen some number for x3, I can compute x2 using this equation, and I can compute x1 using this equation. So since I can choose any number for x3, I could choose 1 or 2 or 3 or minus 7.4 or pi or square root of 2. Since I am free to choose any number for x3, this is actually a family of solutions. There are an infinite number of solutions, and I can write some of them down if I want to choose a particular value for x3. For instance, if x3 is equal to a negative 2, then my solution is x1 equals negative 31, x2 equals negative 18, x3 equals negative 2. Or if I wanted to choose x3 as 3, then the solution would be a negative 16, a negative 8, and 3. I'm just plugging into these equations the value for x3. So these are just two particular examples. I could do this for forever because there's an infinite number. But this is the solution right here in the green box. This is the solution to this system of equations. So this is the last example we'll do in terms of solving systems of equations. In this final example, we've ended up with not just a solution, but a family of solutions, an infinite number of solutions to this system of equations.